Hi viewers, welcome to my channel. Today I am going to discuss about object-oriented programming principles. See, object-oriented programming having several features, so we can get all the features by using these principles. Let us see. Please subscribe my channel. Don't forget to share with your friends. Let us start our object-oriented programming principles. See, first let us see the definition of object-oriented programming. See, object-oriented programming as an approach that provides a way of modularizing programs by creating partition memory area for both data and methods that can be used as templates for creating copies of such modules on demand. See, in object-oriented programming, everything will be treated as objects. So whenever we create object, memory will be allocated. See, whenever we create object, so memory will be allocated. In that memory, we can able to store data and methods. We can create such kind of objects. So whenever if it is required, we can create it from the class. So the class act as a basic template in object-oriented programming concepts. Let us see different object-oriented programming principles. See, object, class, data abstraction and encapsulation, inheritance, polymorphism, dynamic binding and message passing. These are the main object-oriented programming principles. Let us see each and every principle and their advantage. The first thing is object. See, objects are the basic essential runtime entities in an object-oriented environment. See, object is the physically existing component. See, if you take a pen is an object, a mobile phone is an object, a chalk piece an object, a man is an object, everything in the real world, physically existing component is treated as an object. See, every object having some properties and functionalities or behaviors. Properties are nothing but variables. By using variables, we can able to provide data. So that data can be operated by certain methods. So these two are collectively, these two are the properties and behaviors of every object. For example, if you take student is an object. So the properties and functionalities are, see, properties are nothing but variables. So the student properties are student number, student name, student CGPA, email ID, phone number, and so on. Different properties are there. By using these properties, we can able to define the behaviors of the student. So by using get student, put student, taking exams, so attending classes, different behaviors or functionalities by the student by using the properties. And see, object is allocating memory for storing data and operations. In previous slide, we seen object having some properties and methods, behaviors. Properties are nothing but variables and behaviors are nothing but methods. These things, one second. See, object is allocating memory for storing data and operations. See, object is an instantiation to the class because we create objects from the classes. Object is a variable of type class. See, object allocates the memory. See, usually variables in programming, variables are used to allocate the memory because variable is a name given to some memory locations. Here, when we declare any variable, memory will be allocated. Every variable having its data type. Here, object is a variable. So the data type of variable is class type. See, this is the syntax for creating the object. Class name, object name, new class name. Here new keyword is required for allocating memory in Java programming language. Example is, we have a student class. We are creating RAM as an object. So it will allocate memory for RAM. So in that memory, we will store whatever the variables and methods declared inside the class. This is the simple example for creating object. And the next object-oriented programming principle is class. See, class is the core part of the object-oriented programming, because without class, we cannot create the object. See, object-oriented programming usually contains the objects. If you want to create object, we need a class. That's why class is the core part of the object-oriented programming. Class is a user-defined data type. In previous slide, see, we talked about object is a variable of type class. See, variable of type class, that is a one of the data type. That data type usually defined by the user. That's why class is a user-defined data type. A class is a collection of objects. You can able to create many number of objects from a single class. That's why a class is a collection of objects. Class is the collection of both variables and methods. See, we can represent so the properties and functionalities of an object can be represented within a class. If you see, student is a class name. That student class contains, see, these are the variables and these are the methods. This is the simple representation of the class, because class is a collection of both member data and member functions. Member data, nothing but variables. Member functions, nothing but methods. See, from that class, we can able to create different objects. Sam is one object, Ram is another object, Maha, Abhi. We can also create any number of objects. So when we create object, memory will be allocated. In that memory, these properties and these methods will be placed. That's why from the definition, we stated that, it acts as a template. We can create copies of such modules on demand. That is the class here. And the next thing is data abstraction and data encapsulation. See, data encapsulation means the process of wrapping up of data and methods into a single unit. See, that unit is called class. The process is called encapsulation. See, here we encapsulating both data and methods within a single unit. The advantage of making single unit is, so the data is not accessible to the outside world, and only those methods which are wrapped in the class can access it. This data can be accessible by these methods only. This data cannot be accessible from outside of this unit. So in such a way, we can able to provide security to the data. See, this process insulation of the data from direct access by the programs is called data hiding or information hiding. And next, abstraction. Abstraction is the process of presenting essential features only. See, without including the background details, or simply, it is the process of presenting necessary information only by hiding unnecessary information. So that's why class is the concept of data abstraction. So class is also called as abstract data type. And next principle is inheritance. Inheritance is the process of acquiring properties from existing class object to the newly defined class object. See, inheritance supports the concept of hierarchical classification. And in object-oriented programming, the concept of inheritance provides the idea of reusability, because we have existing class. That class contains some properties and methods. These properties and methods can be used by some other class. That means reuse. We can able to reuse some of the things in other programs also. And inheritance also enables us the code extensibility. So extensibility means already we have a class. That class contains some properties. So we can add extra properties to our newly defined class from the existing class. And here, this is the simple diagrammatic representation of inheritance for hierarchical classification. See, we have a bard class is there. That bard class having some properties. from that bird, we are going to define two subclasses. One is flying bird class, another one is the non-flying bird class. From again flying bird class, we are going to classify the flying bird class into some other flying birds. So robin and some other sparrow. These are the two birds, these are the flying birds. Coming to the non-flying birds, penguin and kiwi. These are non-flying birds. See, this is the hierarchical classification of inheritance. And next one is the polymorphism. Polymorphism means many forms, the ability to take more than one form. So that means using the same thing for multiple purpose. See, the polymorphism is classified into two types. One is compile time polymorphism, another one is the runtime polymorphism. If you use the same thing for multiple purpose during compile time of the program, that polymorphism is called as compile time polymorphism. If you use the same thing for multiple purpose during runtime of the program, that polymorphism is called as runtime polymorphism. Compile time polymorphism is also called as static polymorphism. Runtime polymorphism is also called as dynamic polymorphism. See, operator overloading and method overloading are the examples of compile time polymorphism. Operator overloading means, so we can able to use single operator for multiple purpose. For example, if you take plus operator, that plus operator, if you use in between two numerical values, that act as a arithmetic addition. We use that same plus operator in between two strings, that act as a concatenation operation. That means we overload the functionality of that operator. So that is a operator overloading. Coming to the method overloading. Method overloading means more than one method having same name. That means we overload the method name, but different implementations. That is method overloading. This operator overloading and method overloading, these two are happen at compile time. That's why these are the examples of compile time polymorphism. And next, coming to the runtime polymorphism. Dynamic method dispatch is the example for runtime polymorphism. Dynamic method dispatch means at runtime, see, the overridden methods can be resolved. See, by it will decide dynamically which method is being executed. That is runtime polymorphism concept. And the next one is dynamic binding. Binding means linking between the procedure call to the procedure definition or method call to the method definition. Binding refers to the linking of procedure call to the code to be executed in response to the procedure call. See, the binding is classified into two types. One is static binding and dynamic binding. Static binding is also called as early binding. Dynamic binding is also called as late binding. See, static binding means that the code associated with a given method call is known at the time of the call at compile time. Coming to the dynamic binding means that the code associated with a given method call is not known until the time of the call at runtime. That is dynamic binding. And the final principle is message passing. In object-oriented programming, we have a number of objects are there. So we can able to establish communication between these objects by sending and receiving the messages. So that is nothing but message passing. Here we have, for example, three objects are there. See, object one wants to access object two data. So it needs to send message to the object two. So likewise, object two can send and receive messages from object one and object three. So this is nothing but message passing. Through message passing, objects can be communicated with each other in object-oriented programming. See, thank you for watching. See, please don't forget to subscribe my channel and share with your friends. Thank you for watching.